We'll move on to the next topic. This one, I guess you could call maybe a post-mortem to a sense. So, GameIndustry.biz had a very, very illuminating article for anyone who is curious about Square Enix and their Western studios. The article's titled, Square Enix's Western Studios Were, quote, a train wreck in slow motion. And this one shares some of the thoughts of Eidos Montreal's founder, Stéphane Diestus, and how just he reflects on his time when he was overseeing things over at Eidos Montreal, and just his interactions with Square Enix management in Japan and everything. It's written by James Batachelor, and just really, really interesting article because it goes over Diestus's sort of things on just why he sort of butted heads with the Japanese management side of Square Enix when Square Enix had bought Eidos and Crystal Dynamics and everything many, many years ago. And really just it's a bit sad because of course just he did help found the studio and he loved a lot of the teams and everything, but just he makes points that the numbers, the sales numbers that they got for their games were good, but they sort of used traditional and conventional methods to try to sell their games. And it just wasn't kind of like up to current with how to sell and market games and everything. And one of the big things that he had mentioned during the talks of the purchase and everything when Square Enix was going to buy them up was, quote, I hope when Square Enix purchased Eidos in 2009, that things would change. So he pinned a lot of his hopes that just maybe with Square Enix overseeing the studio, maybe with their cash coffers, that maybe they could help them with selling the games better and things like that. So that the purchase happens, and naturally just there were things that sort of repeat themselves over and over and over again. And of course, one of the things that he mentions was that he felt that a lot of the great IPs that were in the Crystal Dynamics and Eidos catalog were just kind of just being put in the deep freeze. I'm sure this is probably going to rile up a lot of people. A great example that he quotes is the Legacy of Kain series, which I know that's going to rile up a lot of people. Just with me mentioning that series has been on the deep freezer.
Oh, yeah. God, how long has it been? It's been, has it been original Xbox since we've had a Legacy of Kain? Don't look it up.
That's a good question.
Yeah, don't look it up. We've looked up it enough today. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong. I'm sorry. But I think that's the last one I remember. I think it's Defiance is what it's called. I think. Oh, I kind of want to look it up.
Yeah.
No. But okay. Yeah, they mismanaged those properties pretty much. I mean, they could have. I mean, we mentioned it when Embracer bought them for $300 million. Like, they could just do remasters of or ports of those properties and make that money back quick. Like, and that's just how much Square Enix mismanaged those studios. I mean,
yeah. And the article kind of goes further into mentioning 2011's Deus Ex Human Revolution, which was after the Square Enix purchase and everything. Right. The fact that it was critically acclaimed and beloved and put Eidos Montreal on the map. Mm-hmm. And then right around 2014, you had Thief, the reboot, which was less than stellar. And And Destuce's sort of opinion on the Thief game was that it was one of his favorite projects, and he felt that the game could have used an extra 9 months just to make a game that would have been a little better to its, to the Thief legacy. And the one thing that just I have railed Square Enix about with their mismanagement of the Western studios is there always seems to be a lot of favoritism towards the Japanese games. That if a Japanese game underperforms, Square Enix would just kind of pull the stops and just go, oh, well, you know, the game's just not maturing yet. We'll come back in a little while. It's okay. Don't worry about the performance. This Japanese game is doing. It'll get better. Just you have to wait.
Yeah.
And then on the flip side, when it came to their Western stuff, it would just be a completely polar opposite. It'd just be like, nope, this game is a critical failure. It is garbage. It couldn't sell past some sort of ridiculous goal. And a great example of this was the reboot of Tomb Raider.
Yeah.
Initially, the sales projection goal that they had was it needed to beat the Call of Duty game of that year. And I mean, for anyone who may not be in the know about this, the people who play Tomb Raider and the people who play Call of Duty, not typically the same group.
Nope. I think they also remade the character, so you couldn't use, let's say, the more salacious tactics of marketing that you could have before. So you're automatically putting them on their heels a bit when it comes to making more sales. So, yeah, but you're absolutely right. Two different groups of people entirely. Like, but even then, it still sold pretty well, didn't it? It sold about, why do we keep doing this?
Yeah, I don't have the exact numbers, but I know it sold pretty well, and a lot of kind of people in the video games business area had said, yeah, it sold kind of well. And then when the quarterly financials came out, and Square Enix had said, yeah, so Tomb Raider, commercial failure. A lot of video game financial analysts were just kind of scratching their heads going, those are solid numbers. Are the gangbusters numbers? No, but they're plenty solid. So
yeah.
How on earth is this considered a failure? And then, of course, if you look into the Square Enix financial report after Tomb Raider the reboot came out, it's a story as old as time. Just Square Enix would say something to the tune of, you know, the game just is a commercial failure. It failed to sell past Call of Duty, so therefore just the game underperformed, and you know, just that's just what it is. And it's funny in this article because, of course, D'Astuce mentioned exactly the scenario that I've been railing about forever, because some people are just like, oh, well, you know, maybe Square Enix is just being tough on the Western studios because they're just being tough, and maybe they're not playing favorites with the Japanese games. And the quote that D'Astuce mentions in this article is, quote, I hope that Square Enix Japan would bring great things to Eidos. I was losing confidence in my headquarters in London. In their annual fiscal reports, Japan always added one or two phrases saying, we were disappointed with certain games, they didn't reach expectations, and they did that strictly, emphasis mine, for games that were done outside of Japan.
This smells a little like a negotiation thing, but a way to not give more financial incentives to those studios. Because, like, let's say, I don't know, let's say, like, X studio needs to make X sales, Y sales to get a bonus at the end of the year for the studio. I wonder if this was a methodology from Square Enix to say, yeah, we want you to make games for us, sure. but we don't want to pay you what you want. So we're going to make these sales expectations so stupidly high that there's no way for you to actually make it. Thus, then, and by doing that, we then don't have to pay you your incentives in order for that we are required to by law under your contract. Because this really smells dirty to me. I think it may just be that Japanese developers prefer Japanese developers, and they could give the fuck all for what the American ones or the other ones do. But it just really sounds to me like they looked at the studios. They were like, okay, that's great. Well, we signed a contract where we have to give them all these incentives if they make sales goals. What if we make those sales goals unrealistic? Then we don't have to give them the incentives. And there you go. You have a quality studio that's doing quality work that you don't have to pay much for. I mean, I think that's possibly what happened.
Yeah. And this kind of goes into a podcast that I did with another podcast, a friend of mine. Just during the time that the Tomb Raider reboot got just a thrashing on the financial report, I believe this was when they were still doing sales numbers on Final Fantasy 13. And for those who have forgotten, 13 was not one of the hottest selling Final Fantasies in a good while. And in that same financial report, they made all sorts of excuses for 13 underperforming. It was just stuff like, oh, well, you know, just 13 just needs a little bit more more time to mature on its sales. It's okay. Just as is it great? No, but you know, just it's Final Fantasy, so you know we're willing to have a little bit more faith that the sales will mature and just get to where they need to be over time. And yet, here you are with just a game that had been beloved by many because it was a very, very interesting reboot on the Tomb Raider franchise in general, and just got critical acclaim, and of course, because of the fact that it didn't outsell Call of Duty, it was just considered absolute garbage.
Yeah.
And the cycle would also repeat for Deus Ex Human Revolution, same thing, just critically beloved and just completely adored by so many people. And then, of course, same sales goal set by Square Enix. Hey, in order for this game to be considered a success, it needs to be the current Call of Duty. And Deus Ex players and Call of Duty players, not very much overlap there either. So, naturally, it undersold. So, again, just the quarterly sales report right after Human Revolution released. Oh yeah, just Deus Ex, complete failure. Just didn't even meet the numbers of Call of Duty, nor surpass them. So, yeah, just commercial garbage to us.
And Final Fantasy 13 wasn't that the game that was so expensive they made a new engine for the entire game, and they had to make two new games just to recoup the cost of the engine itself? Is that true that I heard? This was a long time ago, so I might be wrong on that, but I heard
so,
that. Go ahead.
A short history lesson on 13. So 13 originally was a PS2 game being made in the now dead Luminous engine. Mm-hmm. And it's just super pretty, just took all the knowledge that they had from both Final Fantasy X and Final Fantasy XII and just pushed it so hard, and just they found that 13's initial development on PS2 just hit a bottleneck. They're just like, yeah, we don't think the system can do it. So it gets pushed onto PS3 and Xbox 360 naturally, and of course just again, just they just try to make the game, and they find out that their new Luminous engine has its own limits, so they're just like, well, shit, just we can't tell the entire story that we want to tell, so we have to make a Final Fantasy 13 universe for this and break this up.
Yeah.
And it was supposed to be three additional games if you remember, because there was 13-2, 13 Versus, and then 13-3, Lightning Returns. And then, of course, 13 Versus had its own development issues that it got spun off and turned into Final Fantasy 15 as we know it.
That's right. That's right. You're right. Absolutely. I remember that. God, that's a disaster. And yet, you're right. And they did not cite any disappointments or any ill will or any ill feelings about the game. They defended it constantly. Yeah, I remember that. I guess that's a good thing that Square Enix doesn't have those studios anymore. Because I guess it's clear that they either expected too much from them or it just didn't fit with the core values of Square Enix. So they pretty much, as soon as they got them, they abused them to a certain extent. So I guess it's good that they're no longer together. I am looking forward to what they do with Deus Ex and with Hitman. They don't have Hitman, that's right. I keep
thinking, IO Interactive went completely independent.
Right. Because I keep thinking of Hitman Go. But yeah. It's going to be a good thing that these studios are going to be able to do their own thing and do the games that I think made them who they are. So, yeah, I mean, it sucks they went through that, but they're going to come out of it, I think, in a better place at the end. So that's going to be interesting. I'm really looking forward to seeing what they come up with, Eidos Montreal and the other companies that spun off from Square Enix. So, yeah. Any more that you have on that?
I think there's been a lot of chatter on the internet that people are already taking bets on when Embracer Group is going to say, hey, by the way, Eidos Montreal is going to be remaking Soul Reaver 2, so if you've been wanting some Soul Reaver action, here you go. We've got it by the shovelful.
I mean, that's got to happen, though. I mean, that's got to be soon, too, because that's one property that everyone's like, when are we going to get a new Soul Reaver? When are we going to get a new Soul Reaver? And that would be the smartest thing to do, is to remake 1 and 2 and just put it out there, or even just port it. Port the game to the Switch. Port it to the Xbox and PlayStation, and you got instant sales. I mean, that would be the smartest thing to do at this point. So, yeah, I would. Would that be a Game Awards announcement, you think?
Possibly.
Yeah.
Especially if they get things organized and go, okay, so we got our shit organized. All right, so we got a big announcement. Boom. You remember how we bought up Eidos Montreal and all the Square Enix West studios? Well, we got a treat for you. Bam! Soul Reaver Collection. Soul Reaver 1 and 2, all in one download, one disc, one cartridge, whatever the hell we plan to release this thing on.
Yeah.
And you can get it at date such and such.
Would make sense to me. So, yeah. I'm with you. I think that will happen. I think that'll happen sooner than later.